said, I'm one of the pastors here at the church. I'm just really excited that you're able to be here with us this afternoon. We are in this great season of Lent, which has just always been a season in our church where God has met with us, directed our paths as individuals and as a community in some really important ways. So I'm excited for what God has for us this afternoon. I'm going to begin this afternoon with a story from my childhood, and I just want you to know, don't worry, if you know my sister Bethany, I want you to know that I've already cleared my sharing this story with her. So I am a little bit more than 6 years older than my sister, a difference which seems less significant the closer I get to 40, but when we were children, that was a huge difference. I mean, six years and a bit. And now, I'm ashamed to say, however, that age difference didn't mean that I was completely nurturing and passionate. You might think, right, if you're, the 11-year-old older brother of a 5-year-old little girl, that would just be, the third parent or something. No, that's not how it went. We managed to still do our own rendition of the sibling thing. And as one might expect, though, the banter was pretty much one-sided. If a 10-year-old loses a battle of wits with his 4-year-old sister, he's doing something wrong. But that didn't stop us from arguing, from sort of contesting appearances. And neither did our age difference leave us lacking a common ground, a common value for understanding our quibbles. The rules were well-defined, though they had never been explained to either of us, and frankly, looking back on it, it's amazing how quickly my sister caught on to the basic currency of our disputes. The rule of the game was fairness. Somehow, both of us understood from an early age that there was a big score sheet in the sky that kept track of how many French fries, how many turns on the computer, how many dollars of allowance, and how many pieces of Halloween candy each of us received. And the object of this game of fairness is to try to get an advantage on that tally. Your only defense from your adversary taking what you wanted was an appeal to the judge, mom or dad, on the grounds of fairness. Pretty much every swindle that I ever perpetrated against my sister centered around an issue of fairness. The worst of these occurred when we were, I think, roughly 10 or 4. We were on a long family road trip, and you have to know, for back after the story, our family was fairly health conscious. Candy was pretty much just a Halloween and Easter thing, except for during a road trip. On a road trip, we would sometimes stop, and we could each buy something out of a rest stop vending machine. Now, that probably doesn't sound all that exciting to you, but given the kind of tight control that there was generally over the flow of sugar and candy, the M&Ms that would come from that machine were culinary gold, and Oasis in the desert, a childhood marked by turkey burgers washed down with caffeine-free Diet Coke. So this one trip, we were going along, we all stopped, and both my sister and I selected bags of M&Ms, and we returned to the family minivan with our treasures. A ways down the road, we've been eating our M&Ms, I turned to my sister and told her, "Oh, Bethany, I'm out of M&Ms. Would you be willing to share some of yours with me? Maybe it's puppy dog eyes." She, being the kind-hearted soul that she was, basically split the rest of her M&Ms in half, and we just shared the rest of her M&Ms. Just amazing, right? Aw, my sister's a wonderful person. It was once we finished her M&Ms that it reached next to me and pulled out the rest of my M&Ms. And then I relished eating every last one in front of her, sharing
very honest.
Yeah, that was bad. Now I will have you know that I confessed publicly. I shared this story at Bethany and Sean's wedding, and I paid back what she was owed with substantial interest. But the important things about the hold that fairness has on our imaginations, and often with good reason. Not only was fairness the grounds of the appeal for restitution from my parents, not only did it serve as the universal legal principle of childhood, but it seemed that more than an extra piece of candy or any other advantage gained, unfairness was perhaps the greatest offense. Looking back on it, I think either of us cared nearly as much about the item at stake as we did about the fact that unfairness was going to be perpetrated against us. We don't have to teach a child about fairness. If you, any of you here have young children, you can vouch for that. Fairness is, as I said, a fundamental legal principle of childhood. It seems to be an instinctual part of human nature, a concern that each of us get our fair share. And let's not pretend that the appeal of fairness ends by the time we enter adulthood, and fairness continues to hold sway over us, particularly in American culture. Fairness is a sort of quasi-religious ideal. The rhetoric of America is a rhetoric of fairness, and it resonates deeply with that five-year-old within each of us from the outset, convinced that life should be fair. The problem is, of course, that as each of us hears from an adult at some point in our childhood, life is not fair. Even worse, I'm going to argue this afternoon that God isn't all that invested in fairness either. God is highly invested in justice, I think. God is invested in love, absolutely. But fairness, maybe not so much. In fact, I think that left unchecked, our obsession with fairness is killing some of our most important, most intimate relationships. And instead, what we need to build the sort of relationships we want is to, as we've been discussing in our Lenten series, take the loss. To cultivate the sorts of relationships we want, to build the sorts of communities that we want to live in, we need to learn to embrace losing at the fairness game. Because the sorts of relationships we want are based not merely on fairness, but rather on love. And love and fairness, while certainly not incompatible, are really two very different ways of thinking about relationships. Each one invites us to see ourselves in very different ways, vis-a-vis people and potential conflict. And we need to be willing to take the loss, because being willing to take the loss makes no sense within a fairness perspective. And for that reason, actually helps us kind of reorient ourselves, because taking the loss makes no sense within a fairness mindset, but it makes plenty of sense from the point of view of love. So taking the loss helps remind us and reinforce to others whom we love that the foundation of our relationship is not a legal commitment to non-harm and recourse to adversarial third-person, if not third-party, processes of retributive justice, but rather the foundation of our relationships is an abiding love that is able to outlast the wrongs that we will inevitably incur at one another's hands whenever we dare to entangle our lives in the ways that genuine love drives us to do. That's where we're headed this afternoon. Think about what it would look like to take the loss relationally as a way of establishing the foundation of love in our most important and most intimate relationships. Before we go any further, Father, we do have this fairness thing hard in us. There's enough truth in it that that's not something we totally want to get rid of. But Lord, I pray that you lead us into something deeper, something richer than you're calling us to. Different way of relating, different way of knowing ourselves. It was my first year out of college that God really started rocking my world with this fairness stuff. A bunch of us, 11 of us, were sharing a house on Lake Place, behind the old gym, if you know where it is, here in New Haven. The house came to be called affectionately the Porter House, on the basis of a dubious claim that Cole Porter had at one time lived there. I think that's not true, but that's probably the only thing. God did amazing stuff in the lives of every member of that community that sort of intentionally decided to live together in a Christian community. However, it was not all that easy. As it turns out, living with 10 of your closest friends is not always as much fun as it originally sounds. The main problem, frankly, was it was that whole living together thing. We had 3 separate apartments, one for the 3 girls, 2 for the guys, but a shared common kitchen. We had, there was only one functioning kitchen in this house. One kitchen, we had central cooking schedule, shared rent, shared utilities, grocery bills, etc. We wanted a deep sense of community, and working together on so many of these basic things was a great way to help create that community. We didn't just want to be roommates. And the problem with that whole plan of intentionally entangling our lives with one another was that it worked really, really well. Our lives were entangled. We were dependent on one another. And as if we were one big newly married couple, we all found out that there were these annoying little things about each other that we had never known before. Little things quickly became huge issues. More and more, God made it clear to us that the fight for love, for community, and for fellowship was going to be won or lost on the battlefields of cooking shifts, chore assignments, grocery trips, home improvements, and the like. I think we're all caught off guard a little by how small the challenges seemed, and we were appalled, I think, by how difficult they were to master. It wasn't more than a couple days, really a couple days, into the Porterhouse experience that the demon fairness first reared its ugly head. So-and-so had worked on painting all day, so it was only fair that somebody else cooked dinner, but the problem was that somebody else who had been picking up the dishwashing slack and felt indignant to be called upon again. I don't have to explain this to you. If you've seen any reality television or ever had a roommate, you know how this goes. It was back to elementary school, the game was on, and the only rule was fairness. And it was just as this was starting to heat up, just as I was starting to build resentment for some of my housemates whom I thought weren't doing their fair share, that God brought me to this passage in 1 Corinthians 6 that Josh shared a few weeks back. If any of you has a dispute with another, do you dare to take it before the ungodly for judgment instead of before the Lord's people? Or do you not know that the Lord's people will judge the world? And if you are to judge the world, are you not competent to judge trivial cases? Do you not know that we will judge angels? Don't ask me about that. I can't. I have nothing to talk about. How much more the things of this life? Therefore, if you have disputes about such matters, do you ask for a ruling from those whose way of life is scorned in the church? I say this to shame you. If you're feeling ashamed, that's good. That's my goal. Is it possible that there is nobody among you wise enough to judge a dispute between believers? But instead, one brother takes another to court, and this in front of unbelievers. The very fact, now, so we've already kind of talked about, all right, so there's a problem coming up in the community, the question is, should you take somebody to court? That is a pretty bad, no one in Porterhouse never actually took anybody to court. All right, it may have become because of the intervention of this passage early on in the experience, because there were some rough things. Okay, but then, so Paul gives that argument, and then he sort of backs up and says, all right, hold on, I've kind of gotten off track, let's go back an earlier step. The very fact that you have lawsuits among you means that you've already been completely defeated. Why not rather be wrong? You think that the court is your place of last resort. We did our best. We tried to work it out. What can I say? I need to sue this person. He says, no. You have another stop before that. Just be wrong. Just be cheated. That'll stop the like going to court thing. Then we don't have to argue about which sort of court you ought to take this case to. Why not rather be wronged? Why not rather be cheated? Instead, you yourselves cheat and do wrong, and you do this to your brothers and sisters. I say this to shame you. Why not just be wronged? Why not rather be cheated? That hurts, right? I mean, what could be more un-American, right, than the thought that, like, why don't you be wronged? Like, here's an idea. It sounds like you're in a bit of trouble. You have this disagreement. It's pretty rough. Have you ever thought about just being wronged? You ever thought about just taking the loss? When I read those words 15 years ago, they jumped off the page. Why? What did I really have to lose that God wouldn't replace? I mean, I had some assurance. I felt like I was experiencing it in my daily life. I'll tell you something about that first year of college. It wasn't a lot of money. It was easy to kind of make sure that everything was taken care of for. But I had experienced the sort of provision of God in money and in time and in various sorts of resources. So I knew that God had promised me what I needed, but I was living my life in the house as if there was a chance that I would give too much and end up short. As if at the end of the day, I was going to somehow do one extra shift or right, kind of give too much. And at some point, I would bring my complaint to God, and God would be like, man, I provided everything you needed, so long as you made sure your roommates were fair to you. And now that you haven't held to fairness, I'm sorry. I will not provide what you need now. Right, this seems unreasonable. Why not just be cheated? Now, I will come back to this principle multiple times. In fact, I felt as I was telling you the story of cheating my sister at M&M's that some of you were worried that I'm not giving you a sermon to explain to you why that was totally justified. That is not the point. I'm not talking about just letting people off the hook or enabling unhealthy behavior or being a doormat. It wasn't about the other people in the house at that point. At the moment that I read this passage, God made it clear that the issue was me and my heart, whether I was willing to forfeit my rights in order to better love my friends in the house. In these sorts of situations, we see that at least one ugly reason that we love fairness so much is that fairness provides a mask behind which we can hide our selfishness. I see this all the time in my life. At home, there are dishes to be done, and I don't want to do them. If I go to my wife and I tell her, Hannah, I don't want to do the dishes. Frankly, I think my time is more important than yours, so I think you ought to do the dishes. This will not go well for me. If, on the other hand, I go to my wife and I invoke fairness, and I say, sweetie, I picked up Junia from school this afternoon. Could you please do the dishes tonight? I can mask the fact that really the issue boils down to me not wanting to wash dishes, and instead make it appear as though I am an impartial judge of fairness. It's like, well, gee, Hannah, you know, I would love to do the dishes. I mean, I really would. But it just wouldn't be fair. I would love to help you out. Believe me, I would. My hands are tied. Really, my concern is for myself, not for what's fair or what's right, but using that language saves me from having to come to terms with my own selfishness and certainly saves me from having to own it in front of my wife. This is the killer thing about the fairness game. It invites us, it requires us even, to step out of our skin and pretend to be neutral judges. And given our brokenness, this is dangerous. We are likely to abuse the moral authority that comes from this pretend neutrality. And given God's preferred alternative, namely love, this is madness. Because, you see, love isn't neutral. Fairness isn't really either, though it pretends to be. But love doesn't even pretend to be neutral. It doesn't aspire to neutrality. Love aspires to partiality on behalf of the other. The New Testament's word for love, agape, fundamentally means prefer it. To love someone is to prefer them, to give them preferential treatment. Love places us firmly within our own skin and asks us to pursue the other's good, not from some imaginary neutral vantage point, but precisely from within our messed up, but inescapably real, subjective perspective, and to do so with extreme positive prejudice. Fairness feigns impartiality in service of our partiality to ourselves, our selfishness. Love sets aside impartiality in order to make room for partiality on behalf of the beloved. As a result, whereas fairness can't fathom just taking the loss, love has every expectation that loss, both real and imagined, will attend any relationship lived with this sort of preference and live in the real world. As we talked about during Lent a couple years back, the Bible is not shy about reminding us that love always has a cost. Indeed, in the Gospel of John, Jesus defines the greatest love precisely as a costly love. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. That's what love is. That's what the highest love is. And if the highest form of love is laying down one's life, we should not be surprised to find that the weaker flavors of love that we pursue daily carry their own costs. We should not be surprised that loving our friends, our families, our communities requires a willingness to take the loss. If the supreme standard of love is laying down one's life, well, then, to put it crudely, when you love on the surface at least, that when you love truly, then at least on the surface, it will look like you are getting ripped off. And this is what can make the fairness game antithetical to the way of love. Because the fairness game can build our resistance to the very thing we most want, to live as people of love within communities of love. Back at Clover House on Lake Place, frankly, there wasn't anybody in the house that wasn't trying to do their part. The problem was that we were all wasting so much time keeping track of tallies in the fairness chart. At one point, there was literally a chart. Maybe that could be an okay thing. It wasn't good for us. We didn't have any energy left to actually go about the business of loving each other as Christ had taught us. I was so worried about getting ripped off, getting a short end of the stick, that my hands were tied in terms of trying to really love my friends. Eventually, my motto in that house became, fairness is the F word of community, a motto I will still recite from time to time. Over that year, I really came to believe this. Fairness can often stand in direct conflict with love. It's a topic for another talk, but for what it's worth, I think actually fairness can be a way for justice as well. For whereas fairness has me concerned about what I deserve, love has me looking for ways to forfeit what I deserve for the sake of others. This is self-sacrificial love. But again, as I said, notice the scale. Notice how small this love was. I knew that love meant laying down my life for my friends. But somehow that seemed easier than washing dishes I didn't dirty or doing chores that weren't mine. How often do we profess to be capable of following Jesus to the cross when we can't follow Jesus to the laundry? How often do we profess a desire to lay down our lives for our spouses but resent picking up a broom? How often do we claim to be willing to take a big loss but can't stomach half a dozen small losses on a daily basis? Figure all this points in. Over that year, quarterbacks, God continually pushed me to make my convictions about God real in the small things of everyday life. And Hannah and I have continued to see this lesson impact our lives as a couple. Why not just be wronged has helped each of us love the other in the midst of the small slights that inevitably crop up and churn life together. Following Jesus to the laundry room has been a really important North Star for me in learning what it means to love my wife well. And Paul's questions have helped us orient ourselves as a couple to the communities that we're members of, the sorts of costly commitments that might be entailed when you decide to entangle your lives with others for the sake of love. Nowhere has that been clearer than in the case of our car. I actually think that cars in modern life are sort of like the place where our sense of like what we deserve and what we're entitled to, right? Some of you who own cars know what this feels like. But we've long been convinced that like the rest of our stuff, our car is not our own. Our car is God's car, purchased with God's money to be used for God's purposes. And that has included loaning it to others in the various communities in which we've been invested over the years. That has entailed costs, from small things like having to schedule our lives around another's schedule because we were sharing a car for a season of life, to the inevitable nicks and scratches that come from driving a car in a city, or somehow much worse when you didn't put them there, to bigger things like finding out that our car had fines from back parking tickets incurred when we were driving the car, to, most dramatically, having to pick our car up from the police impound lot and driving it home, badly damaged, with the letters DWI scrawled on it, the result of a friend having had our car in an accident that went very, very badly. A case in which the indignity of the situation was perhaps as upsetting as the material damage. I hardly drink. Here I was, doing the drive of shame, the DWI car. And yet, in each case, relationships survived. Actually, I think I can honestly say, I was thinking about this as I was writing this, I can honestly say that in each case, relationships are stronger today than they were when our car found its way into this kind of messy world of trying to follow Jesus in the small, everyday things of life. I share these brief anecdotes not as a record of wrongs suffered, but as testimonies to the beautiful things that God has done in our lives through each of the relationships that were refined in the small and large bumps of life together. The history of that car is the history of a bunch of relationships that mean the world to us. Now, I promised a few clarifications. To be clear, neither Paul's endorsement of a willingness to be wronged nor Jesus' ideal of a love that lays down its life amounts to an endorsement of wrongdoing. I hope that goes without saying, right? But this is about choosing to forfeit our own rights, not about disregarding the rights of others. Remember Paul's warning at the end is, you yourselves cheat and do wrong, and you do this to your brothers and sisters, you do this to members of your communities, to your friends, to your family. When we don't forfeit our rights, usually we end up trampling on the rights of those closest to us. And so these two things are actually related. We end up trampling on the rights of our brothers and sisters, our family, our friends, our most important communities. And that's a big deal. Paul takes wrongdoing really, really seriously. Right? And the anti-fairness rhetoric I'm promoting here will offer me no cover when I veer into mistreating those nearest to me. So let's not weaponize this. This is about me and my taking the loss. My fleecing of my sister out of a vow of amends cannot be, for me, a case of my sister needing to take the loss. It's actually not even a funny joke to ask someone that we would be wronged. Why not just be wrong? I forbid you from using that joke in your family or in your apartment. That's not what Paul's saying. Also, that's first definition. Second, you'll note that I was careful to say this is about choosing to forfeit our own rights. It's about choosing to do so. It's not about accepting that we have no rights, or that we have no hope of being afforded rights, or accorded honor and respect by those near to us. This is about choosing to lay down that which most definitely is yours. The greatest love is laying down one's life, not merely having it taken from you. Choosing to forego our rights is not an act of weakness, therefore, but actually an act of strength that affirms our rights and adds to that affirmation the strength required to lay down a right that really is ours. When I lay down my right to receive compensation for a wrong done to me, precisely by laying it down, I acknowledge that I have the right. I am owed compensation, but I demonstrate yet greater strength, the strength because of God's promised provision to do without what I am really owed. Taking the loss is an act of strength. Make no doubt about that. Third, finally, we do not forego our rights because the truth of our having been wronged or having been cheated is unimportant. Again, it's similar to what I just said, but rather in choosing to take the loss as a matter of strength, we speak the truth about the wrong, sometimes implicitly, sometimes explicitly, depending on the case. We speak the truth about the wrong that has been done, and nevertheless, for the sake of love, we choose to keep no record of the nonetheless very real wrong thing. Taking the loss cannot amount to living in some imaginary world. Right? Like, oh, I'm just going to pretend that I live in this space where no one has harmed me. That's not true. And after all, we're taking the loss for the sake of love. And love requires relationship, and relationship requires that we inhabit the same world, which includes sharing the same set of facts about our moral relating to one another. So as Paul does within the community of the Corinthian church in the first passage that we looked at, we will need to speak the truth to one another. Even more, we will need to invite people to speak the truth into our lives. And Josh has some great thoughts on that in the Lent Journal this week, and so I hope you have that and make great use of it. Really helpful in leading us into that part of the equation. So I've been leaning in this direction, but let me just ask the questions that have been sort of implicit the whole way along. What about this community? How can we forfeit our rights? How can we forfeit what we deserve for the betterment of one another or someone else in this church? How could this community be deepened if more of us were willing to be cheated? Could we do that? Are we capable of making those small choices? Do we trust enough in God's abundance in order to be instruments of his generosity to others? Are we willing to just be wrong for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of our brothers and sisters in Christ? Josh has given us this great paradigm for applying the lessons. Looking at in each week, thinking about obedience. Like, what does it mean to follow the commandments of Jesus? About humility, what does it mean to conform to the character of Jesus? And spiritual gifts, what does it mean to step out in the faith of Jesus? This week, first, obedience, following the commandments of Jesus. Josh's invitation from the Lent God is great, so I'll simply commend it to you. Value right relationships. Value right relationships more than being right. That will require some truth speaking. It will probably nevertheless still require some willingness to take the loss. That's the key here. What is more important, being right or having the right relationship? Living out the right answer to that question is the foundation of everything else. So the next time you flinch at doing more than your fair share for your spouse, roommate, co-worker, friend, try out the option of just taking the loss. I mean, that would be hard. But I think if we could habituate ourselves to it, it at least appears as an option for us. It kind of lets us out of this bind that we sort of feel stuck in, where we have to wrestle for every little piece that we feel. Second, going a little bit out of order, spiritual risk. Stepping out of the faith of Jesus. As I mentioned, taking the loss in our friendships does not mean selling the truth down the river. Truth is important. But we often are not the most reliable discerners of the truth in conflicts that involve us. Cigarettes, rather. Particularly in the context of our intimate relationships where the stakes are really high. So I think a risk that we can take this week, and again, the Lent Journal will lead us in this direction, a risk we can take this week is to invite a trusted friend or two to speak the truth into your life. Think about a conflict. Invite a trusted friend and explain to them. That needs to be a third party friend. this is this conflict I mean. Hey, can you help me kind of foresee? Is there something I'm missing here? Am I rightly articulating to you the part of this conflict that's kind of my responsibility? You need to have some trust in someone who knows you well enough to kind of speak hard in those situations, but that's really important. There may be hard truths that you need to hear. Finally, humility, imitating the character of Jesus. As we heard from the Gospel of John, there is no doubt that this whole paradigm of taking the loss of our friends is right at the heart of the character of Jesus. When Jesus taught that no one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends, he, of course, was speaking of himself. The grain of wheat, when it dies, bears much fruit. Jesus calls us his friends, and he laid down his life for us. Mm-hmm. He invites us to do the same for one another. So I'm going to invite the worship team to come forward, and as we do each week, we're going to begin a kind of a time of response that will have a few different pieces to it, but we're going to begin with communion. And in communion, we remember, first of all, the death of Jesus, the one who calls us his friends and demonstrated his love for us by laying down his life for us. But we don't just remember. When we remember, we're also called to imitate that love. When Jesus says, "As I have loved you," the end of that sentence is not, "So also you ought to love me." Jesus is looking for us to reflect his love back to him. He says, so as I have loved you, so also you ought to love one another. Jesus says, look, I have shown you what the greatest form of love looks like. I've laid down my life for you. Do you trust me enough to walk with me into laying your lives down for one another? And so I invite you, if you're a follower of Jesus or if you would like to become a follower of Jesus, I would invite you to come forward as the worship team leads us in worship and to tear off a piece of the bread, Jesus' body broken for us, and to dip it in the cup, his blood shed for us. Both as a way of remembering the demonstration of love that Jesus showed to us on the cross that we celebrate in this Lenten season, but also as a way of saying, Jesus, I don't know exactly what it looks like, and I don't know that I'll have all that it takes, but I know you have all that it takes for me to walk in imitation of this way of life. So Spirit, would you say, would you come and would you be here as we take these elements into our bodies, as this bread and this cup become part of our very flesh? Would you come and give us yourself? Be filled with the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Jesus that would allow us to become the people who love in imitation of that love that laid down its life. In ways large and maybe particularly in ways small, would you lead us